So these are the few things that you need to do as a day one. So Umair, why don't you read?
Day one, understand why projects are initiated and how they are selected. Initiation, project charter, and journey of a stakeholder.
Okay,
The
so
second is
journey of stakeholder, what is journey of stakeholders? Like how they move, you need to understand. Okay, yeah, Umair.
sorry.
Yeah, move forward, please.
Yes, understand three process and operations, three
Three P means project, program, and portfolio.
portfolio and operation,
Yeah, understand them.
life cycle, agile and plan driven,
Okay.
process tailoring, work performance data, work performance information, work performance report, deliverable phases, project constraints. Four values and 12 principles of agile, basics of scrum and do mocks.
Do a generalized mock just to get an idea, to get a taste what it is. Then day number two, it will be a more hectic day, I would say. So Neeraj, please read. Neeraj?
I'm sorry, I was on mute. So day two, master Scrum in Agile. You must understand three roles of Scrum, empirical process, five events of Scrum, three artifacts of Scrum. Then estimation techniques, prioritization technique, velocity, burn-up, burn-down chart, refactoring, osmotic communication, co-location, task board, cumulative flow diagram, task board, user story, story points, personas, Agile. Modeling.
This is more of a Kanban. It is not task board. The second one is Kanban board. So that's a mistake.
Right.
I'll put it Kanban. Okay. Yeah. Modeling,
MVP.
minimum viable product, minimum marketable feature.
Minimum marketable feature, remember.
XP,
XP, X3.
we go with pair programming. What is pair programming? Test-driven development, values of XP. What is continuous integration? What is refactoring? All those things. Then do 180 questions of Agile. You can do that test number six of mine. Okay, you guys have, or you can, there's a guy of PMI ACP mock. He had a good mock. You can do that. Okay, then revise on the third day, revise Scrum and extreme programming, learn lean principles and its ways, seven principles, seven this, then Kanban board, how it is used, how it is linked to work in progress, throughput, what is Little Law, theory of constraint, Kaizen, Crystal, feature for Kaizen, Crystal, and feature-driven development, you just need to understand the basics. You don't need to go the detail. Then on this stage, you need to go to resource communication journey. And then you do mock. You can get a good mock from EDU HubSpot. This is a website. It's a very good learning website. It's basically by Varun Anand. You can get mocks from there, or this PMI ACP mocks are good, or there are also other mocks I will tell you guys. So far till day number three, any confusion?
Nope.
Sir, what is little low?
A Little Law says that if you are in the line, if you are in the line, okay, longer the line, longer it will take for the work to complete. Actually, it says in this way, if the line gets longer, the work, the cycle time will start increasing. If you make a pull system in which your lines are small, you can easily do that thing. Or you go with the journey of quality, journey of risk, journey of procurement, how three baselines are created, what is required to complete these baselines, like journey of resource, how, what can hinder basics of risk and mock of planning, or a good mock covering the complete of these things. Then how quality, go with the quality journey, go with the communication, revise stakeholder, and revise procurement. Okay, then you need to go how to direct and manage the work, manage lesson learns, how basically in execution you do the quality, how you acquire and develop and manage it, how you do the communications among the stakeholders, how you implement it and do the mocks. And then you master change request journey for both sides. We have work performance data journey, EVM, earned value management, deliverable journey, how to ensure stakeholders are satisfied and close the procurement. Then you master closing both of in both processes, you master release, revise these things and prepare these things. Okay, so this is basically an overview of my high level 7-day program. So I would suggest that you can take this as your borderline and start preparing for your exams in that way. Is there any question? Anyone have any question? Yeah?
Not yet.
Okay.
Maybe not.
Journey is journey of work performance, the change request. Sorry. The first journey is journey of change request. Yesterday, I showed you the journey of PMI and the new material, and I was actually happy and a little bit jealous also. They took my material and they started working on it. But I would say it's an honor. What do you think, guys? That PMI?
Yes, it is. But just tell them it's mine. they should give you the credit, na?
Yeah, no issue. Okay, any change request that comes to you, even in agile environment, even in predictive environment, the change request has to come to project manager or product owner in the case of agile. So now what I am focusing on, these journeys are specifically related to predictive environment. So make this sure some of these things will not be implemented in agile. Is this clear? Am I making sense here?
Yes,
please.
The first step, Faransa, please go through the journey.
Okay, without looking. Okay, yeah, so no. We start with, okay. Okay, formal written request. So whenever we receive, so the request should be formal and written. And then we analyze the CR or change request. And that evaluation by the PM, the project manager. So then project manager see if this impacted any baseline. If no impact on baseline, then see PM can approve the change request, update the document, communicate to the stakeholder and team, and send approved CR to direct and manage work. So that's easy. But if it's if impacting the baseline, then that's why we say yes here, then we send this to CCB, which is a control board, change control board, and with the recommendation as well. So why we are sending this, and then CCB analyze and evaluate the change request. So they got three things they can do. They can either approve the change request or defer the change request or reject. Deferred means they said, okay, we can't approve now. We may approve in future. So if it's rejected or deferred by the CCB, then what we will do, we do the document update and change log. And we put that change request in change log. That change request was generated by rejected and deferred. So if it's approved, then we update the baseline. So we go update the three baseline cost baseline, or it depends like which baseline we are updating. But we update, for example, if it's affecting all three baseline, we update the cost baseline and scope baseline and schedule baseline. And if it's, so we update that, then we communicate with the stakeholder. So then this change request will go to approved change request already, and it's all already been updated. The baselines then will go to control quality and control procurement and send to the direct and manage work where this change will be implemented as well. The reason we are sending for control quality and procurement, if it's they can check as well, and procurement, we may buy things from the outside source as well. Then it will be communicated to a stakeholder again. So that's a journey here.
Thank you. Atif, can you just go through again? What is this?
Is it?
Without looking. It's okay. Okay. So what is basically happening here? Okay, Atif, I'll go through it. What is happening if any change request come to you? It has to be in predictive environment, in a written form, in the form of change log. As Farhan Saab said, it is in the form of change log. And when a change comes to project manager, he evaluates that this change request, does this affect any plans or any baselines? If it does not affect any plan or any baseline, then the project manager can approve or deny by himself. If it is affecting plans and baselines, then the change request need to go to change control board. And the change request goes to change control board, where they evaluate the change request, approve or deny the change request. If they deny the change request, then the documents get updated. If they approved it, all the plans and the baselines can get updated. Once they get updated, you communicate to stakeholders, you implement that thing and you communicate to stakeholders again. Is this clear to everyone? Am I
yes,
okay?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Produced? Work performance data?
Yes, when we need to represent the progress of the project.
Okay, where it is produced?
Execution.
Let the person answer from whom I have asked the question, please. Yes, Sheryan.
Okay.
Where it is produced?
During the execution of the project, it is produced.
Which process?
Execution.
Execution is a process group. Which process? There are 49 processes.
I don't remember exactly.
Direct, Sheryan,
if they could be
in direct and manage work, work performance data is generated. Now, what is work performance data, Shazib? What is work performance data?
Observation, sir.
And why do you need them?
We have to go for WPI, work performance information tool, ensure.
You know, what is the purpose of this data? What does this raw observation shows? What does this raw observation shows basically?
The performance of the whole processes which we are doing.
The current performance of the project. Good. So this data goes to all monitoring and control process. Actually, this data is generated and it goes to all the departments from scopes till stakeholder. It goes to all the department where you compare your plan and the actual work. This data is the actual work and you do variance analysis. You do trend analysis. You make reports and you produce work performance information and change request. And this work performance report goes to monitor and control project work and you made work performance report. This work performance information goes to monitor and control project work and you produce work performance report. This work performance report goes to perform integrated change control and it helped in approving the change request. It goes to manage communication and become project communication. It goes to manage team to help in conflict management. It goes to monitor risk so that the risk can be understand, so that the risk can be mastered. Is this clear? Am I making sense here?
Deliverables are produced in the monitoring and controlling phase of integration.
Shazir, just take a sense of this thing. If we produce...
I forgot his name.
Sheikh? Yes, Sheikh?
Yes, I believe it's in execution phase because in execution phase, we got the delivery. So our all...
Shazib, you don't need to remember that. Where work is being done? Work is being done only in one process of all the process of PMP. That is direct and manage work. So that will produce the deliverable. What is that deliverable? Deliverable is something that is produced and that is a workable thing. That's the output. So only one process produces deliverable, that is direct and manage work. You don't need to remember processes, but you need to have understanding here. You don't need to remember any processes, but you need to have an understanding. What is a deliverable? Deliverable is something that is like outcome, and only one process has some tangible outcome in productive environment, that is direct and manage work. Okay. Okay, Shazib.
Okay, got it, sir.
So it produces deliverable. Then once the deliverable has been produced, we go to quality control. Quality control and check whether the deliverables are according to quality standards or not. If they are not, then a corrective, preventive, or defect repair action change request is generated. Then a change request is generated, and we can go to back to the process. If it is approved by quality, it becomes verified deliverables. It becomes verified deliverables. These verified deliverables goes to validate scope, where we check the deliverables with the customer, and if the customer accepts the deliverable, we get accepted deliverable.
And accepted deliverables.
This accepted deliverable goes to close the project, and we get final product or results. Is this clear, everyone? Good, Atif.
Yes, clear.
Lines are created. What are the three baselines? The three baselines are scope, schedule, and cost. Okay. So we are talking about predictive environment. The first thing is to create a scope baseline that defines how the work is going to be done, each and everything. So in order to create the scope baseline, we don't go with just the scope chapter. We go even before that, we go with the project charter. Once the project gets formalized, you get project charter. With the help of project charter, you identify stakeholders. Once that is done, you make project management plan. Okay? From project management plan, the one part is scope management plan. In the scope management plan, you get two plans. Scope management plan as well as requirement management plan.
Requirement.
Let's focus on requirement management plan. Requirement management plan helps us to collect the requirement, and as a result, we get collect requirement documentations, all the requirements of the product that is required, and requirement traceability metrics. Then we in define scope, we define what is in the scope and what is out of the scope. You see, you can have a lot of requirements, but here you will define what is in the scope. That's it. Other things are not in the scope. So you make project scope statement, which tells us what is in the scope, what is out of the scope. Okay. And as a result of project scope statement, you get a complete scope with you. From there, you create work breakdown structure, and project scope statement. Combination of all three is known as scope baseline. The first baseline is created. So first baseline is clear to everyone?
Yes.
Yes.
Atif, Farhan.
Yes, sir.
Naka, Shazib, Sheryar, Neeraj, Bayo.
Yes.
Umair.
Yes.
Sir, will you please repeat once?
What to repeat? What should I repeat? Their output of defined activity. Activity list, activity attributes, and milestone list. Then you sequence these activities. Finish to start, start to start, all those things. You get project schedule network diagram. Okay. Then you estimate duration on those activities. And you get duration estimate as well as basis of estimate. Then once you have duration, you have sequence, you go to develop schedule and you make schedule baseline, schedule data, project schedule, all those things. Is this clear now?
Yes, clear.
Okay. So you get schedule based.
I think this line should be connected to when we do like project schedule network diagram. Then we will go to estimate activities, isn't it?
Yeah, you are right. Why don't you make it? Why don't you make that?
Jab diagram ban gayi hai.
Yeah. The diagram need to show clearly.
Yeah, main to bana lunga.
That's why I'm saying it need to
be. Yeah, clearly. Because when, sorry.
Yeah, oh. You are right. You are 100% right. If you want to differentiate between input and output, then you need to make that. But the thing is that now PMP, it does not matter. You need to understand the sequence. You need to understand the reasons. Why? What are these things? And why? How they take place in the bigger space? Because initially, in the 2020 PMP, you need to understand what about the outputs. Remembering outputs was most important thing. But that's not important anymore. Okay. The most important thing is that how this thing happened. Like you have made a baseline. Now the work, with the help of work package, you make it into the activity and you get activity list. You sequence the activities you get project schedule network diagram. Then you make the duration. Then you make the schedule baseline. And this way, you need to understand those things more than the memorized thing. Yes, Sheikh.
Depending on the sequence, we do create a sprint one, sprint two, sprint three, and more. Is that right?
Yeah. But we are talking about predictive environment.
This is predictive.
Don't take. His understanding.
If you want to do hybrid, I think we can do it here.
His understanding is 100% right. Your understanding is 100% right. But let's focus on the predictive right now. Okay, Sheikh. Okay, Sheikh.
Amir, your voice is cracking.
Everyone else?
Yes, I'm good.
Are you feeling this as same issue or is this with Neeraj?
No.
Yes, I'm feeling the same issue.
Me also.
Yes, sir. Same. Kuch signal ka problem hai aapka.
Mere khayal aaj log bahut istemal kar rahe hain network Pakistan.
Three holidays. So we have three holidays, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Oh, that's why I think, yeah.
Siley also saying the same. Connectivity issue, not able to hear.
Okay, now can you hear me? I changed my internet. Now is it okay?
Yes.
Much better. Okay.
Everyone is thinking of problem mere end pe.
Main to apne network se speak kar raha tha.
Okay.
I thought myself that I am changing my network as well.
Okay. Then we have a cost. In cost, we estimate on the same activity we made, we get cost estimates, and when we combine the cost estimate, we get cost baseline. And then we have to control this cost baseline through earned value. Okay? Okay?
Yeah, I mean, right, can you repeat this? Sorry. I think cost management, can you?
Cost management plan. Cost management plan tells us how you make cost baseline. It tells us how you control the cost. So in estimate cost, you get activity cost estimate and basis of estimates. Then in deployment budget, you do bottom-up estimation and cost aggregation and funding limit reconciliation. You get cost baseline and project funding requirement. Then you go to in the control, you will have three baselines that you have. Then the next step is in the control cost. Now, this is very important. For exam point of view, these formulas are more important. Just let me remove it. Yeah, Sheikh, in the meantime, you can ask your question.
What is the difference between estimate cost and cost estimates?
That's the same thing. Estimate cost is a process. As a result, you get activity cost estimate. It should be activity cost estimates. Okay?
Okay.
So, in the control cost, these two formulas, schedule variance, that is earned minus and schedule performance index, earned value divided by planned value, and CPI, earned value divided by actual cost and cost variance. These formulas are the most important formula, and you will get at least 1 to 2 questions from it. Okay? So do master these two formulas, schedule variance, cost variance. Okay. Okay. So moving to the next, this is how three baselines are created. Then we have quality. Shariar?
Yes, sir.
Can you just help me? In plan quality, what do you do?
We, first of all, manage quality and by quality.
First, in metrics. Plan quality, how you manage the quality? By first, you are in the plan.
We define quality inspection plan. Yes. And
we make quality management plan, not quality inspection plan. Shariar, what quality standards you are going to follow? You do cost of quality, benchmarking, benefit and cost analysis, all this. You get quality management plan and quality matrices. Then in manage quality is actually quality assurance. You make test and evaluation documents. Okay, you make quality reports, and then it goes to control quality. We already know the purpose of the control quality is to make verified deliverables. Okay, and quality control measurements. Is quality clear to everyone?
Yes.
Yes, please.
So manage quality is QA and control quality is QC. Or like.
Yes. Anyone else? Any question?
No, please. Understood.
Okay, thank you. Okay, let's move forward. So now the next topic is resource management. Resource management is very important in the new PMP. So once you are planning the resource, you need to know about the diversity of the team. You need to understand the emotional intelligence of the team. You need to understand if you have virtual team, how you are going to manage the virtual team. Tuckman ladder, we discuss it important. Maslow hierarchy of need, situational theories, how adaptive leadership is there, theory X, theory Y, expectance theory, theory of motivation. As a result, you create resource management plan and team charter. Team charter is a very important document that gives a value, that gives a ground rules that a team must follow. Then we have estimate activity resource, which give us activity estimates and resource estimate. So these are, then once we have the estimates, we acquire the resources, in which we get all the kind of resources. Then we develop the resources, okay? You develop the resources, you resolve the conflict, you go through the Tuckman ladder theory, then you manage through conflict management, all those things. And finally, once the work is done, you release those resources. Is this clear to everyone? Am I making sense here?
Yes, you are.
Okay. You plan the
situation.
You get right format at right time to right person to have a right impact. So you plan for communication. Who is authorized for the communication? Who you create the communication? You distribute the communication. You ultimately dispose of the communication and manage communication. In monitor, you ensure the stakeholders are satisfied. That's all about communications, communication models, how you communicate from encoder to other person. The pull communication, interactive communication, the written communication, the verbal communication, knowing the culture awareness, the political awareness, all those things. Okay, understanding which technology is required. Like if there's urgency, then you don't text, you call. And understanding that information radiator in agiles are used, how you make burn down chart, what is osmotic communication, the communication that naturally flows from one person to another, okay? Active listening, managing the meeting, and understanding the need of the stakeholder and fulfilling those needs. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Any question in communication?
No.
Okay, thank you.
No.
Okay, Sailee, thank you. So next is the my favorite topic, risk.
Mm-hmm.
So in risk has 7 processes. First of all, you identify the tolerance of the organization, the appetite, risk averse, risk seeker. You make risk management plan. Then you identify all the risk. Okay, and identification of risk is iterative. It keeps on happening. Once you get the risk register from identification, then you rank the risk as low risk, medium risk, high risk. you categorize the risk. Through qualitative, you rank it low, medium, high. Then you do quantitative risk analysis, where you utilize Monte Carlo, Tornado, expected monetary value, influence diagram. Once you have ranked the risk, then you make response for positive as well as negative risk. Avoid, mitigate, transfer for negative risk. Exploit, enhance, share. Accept for both, both of them. Active acceptance is known as contingency reserves. You make a plan A, plan B. Then you have fallback plan. You have reserves analysis from them. Then you see what are the residual risk, what are the secondary risk, who is the risk owner, what is basically risk trigger, all those things. And in monitor risk, you see the risk effectiveness. Okay, you do the risk audit and you close the risk and you keep on doing this. So this is a journey of risk. Is this clear?
Yes.
Passive risk, we have work, passive acceptance, we have workaround.
Okay. Workaround, yeah.
Is this clear to everyone?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So let's move to the journey of procurement. Now, this is one of my favorite journey. Like this, I think the way that one of my students made this journey was excellent. Okay. So first of all, you do analyze what you want to do, okay? What you want to have. Once you analyze that, you do make or buy analysis. Should I want to make it or I want to buy it? Once you have done that, you select which type of source you are going to have. You have a source selection criteria. You see which type of contract to use, fixed type contract, cost reimbursement, time and material. Then you make project statement of work. Once project statement of work is made, you advertise that opportunity. You have a bidder conference where the proposal is submitted, proposals are evaluated, proposals are shortlisted. You negotiate with the sellers, you select the sellers, you have agreement with the sellers, and then you deliver the product. You inspect the product. Once the product is delivered, you do inspection. And if the contract allows, you do audit. If there's a dispute occur, you do dispute resolution. You resolve the conflict, you close the procurement, update the document, and then send this procurement document to close the project. Is this clear to everyone?
Yes.
Okay. This is an important journey, actually, no?
Yeah.
Jake, is this clear?
Yes.
Yes, I'm.
Yes, sound
good. Then
and we close the project in closing in close the procurement in procurement dozen control procurement.
Control. So the last journey is the journey of stakeholders. You identify the stakeholder through various documentation. Once the stakeholders are identified, you rank the stakeholder through power interest matrix. To salience model to stakeholder queue. On the stakeholders have been ranked, then you see what are the, like from the important stakeholders, from the high power, high interest or high power, low interest, you see which stakeholders need engagement, like what is the current engagement level, what is the desired engagement level. And you make stakeholder engagement plan, stakeholder engagement plan to cover all the strategy, to change their current engagement into your desired engagement level. Then you manage the stakeholder engagement throughout the process. Throughout the process, you manage the engagement of the stakeholders. Then you monitor their engagement throughout the process to see how you can improve stakeholder engagement. And this is all about the stakeholder engagement. Is there any question, anyone?
I mean, what's the salience model? Because I thought I explained it.
In salience model, we have three things: power, urgency, and legitimacy. And we rank the stakeholders according to their power, what is their urgency for something, and what is their legitimacy. We also have stakeholder cube in which we refer them through power, interest, and their attitude. Okay? Ground rules are very important here. So any question, anyone here?